Welcome to Sports Tonight Live presents The Cage. We've got such an exciting show for you today. I'm so excited about what's going to happen. With me, as always, is my partner in crime, number 48, Mr. Brad Wharton. Brad, good to see you.
Good to be back, as always, Brett.
Our first guest today, like I said, I'm so excited. You know, we all have people that we sort of look up to in our professions, people that that inspire us. Today, we've got Lenne Hardt, legendary Pride announcer. I don't even know what to say.
It's the best day of my life already.
Absolutely. Hi, Lenny. Are you there?
I am here.
So good to see you. I'm so glad you took time out. I know it's the middle of the night in Tokyo for you. Really, really appreciate you taking the time to come on the show with us today.
It's my pleasure. Thank you for having me.
So big announcement in the last couple weeks. You are now the new announcer for ONE FC. That's brilliant. Back in front of us, entertaining us all once again.
I only heard part of that, the part about entertaining you all again. I'm assuming you're referring to ONE FC, correct?
Yes, exactly.
Oh, yeah, I'm really excited about that. Yeah, actually, I was excited about doing Pride and Dream as well, but this is a whole new ballpark opening up, or a whole new cage, I should say, opening up now.
Yeah, exactly. So how long have you been announcing?
Oh, for mixed martial arts, I've been announcing since the year 2000. I did my first MMA bout was the Grand Prix at the Tokyo Dome in 2000, the Pride Grand Prix. Sorry, it's after just past midnight, and I've been shaken by a couple of earthquakes this morning, so forgive me if my brain's a little bit shaken, too. My 2000 makes it, what year is this, 2012?
Yeah.
So professionally announcing for mixed martial arts since 2000, so for 12 years.
That's amazing. And what brought you to that first event? You know, I mean, here you are and here Pride is, and they rang you up one day and said, "Hey, Lenny, how about it?"
Yeah, basically that is what happened. I've told this story numerous times, but it's people seem to like to hear it, so I'll go ahead and tell it again. I was called up 2 days before the Grand Prix by one of my agents who said, listen, there's this quote-unquote boxing thing going on at the Tokyo Dome. She knew no more about mixed martial arts than I did. They want someone who's bilingual and who won't be shy in front of about 50,000 people at the Tokyo Dome. And I said, that's me. So I looked at my schedule and I happened to be free 2 days later. So I said, sure, why not? I'll try anything. And the rest, as they say, is history.
Well, yeah, exactly. And so over the course of your Pride career, how many events did you do?
You know, I don't really know exactly. I know for a good number of years there we were doing one a month at least, but then it became once every other month. It sort of dwindled down to fewer since then, and I've been doing Dream for the past 3 years. So I'd say probably about maybe 75, 80, and I've also done some other mixed martial arts organizations as well. So I think it probably rounded out to about 80.
And you mentioned Dream there as well, so just carrying the legacy right on into Dream and now into ONE FC.
Yes, because Dream is co-promoting with ONE FC as well. And in fact, the next one that we're going to be doing in Singapore on the 31st of March will be a Dream co-promotion event with ONE FC.
Oh, yeah. So they're working together on that. That's, yeah, fantastic. Yeah. So are you yourself, are you a fight fan?
I am now. I knew nothing about it when I first did the job. Nothing whatsoever. Had never even heard of it. But I'm a huge fan now, yes. Very much so. How about yourself, Brett?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I mean, I work several shows across the UK, as you know. And I'm always looking at the cards.
Oh, I know. Hey, Brett, I looked you up before I accepted this interview.
Surprised you accepted it, then.
I know your resume now.
And you agreed to come on anyway.
Hey, I'm a big fan of yours now.
Fantastic. I appreate that. So as you see ONE FC coming, I mean, they've already been called, you know, the biggest promotion in Asia. And as you see the sport, I guess, evolving kind of on your side of the world, how do you see it from the old Pride days to what you're seeing through Dream and now with ONE FC?
Well, in some ways, very similar. Certainly from some of the North American organizations now, quite different. It's just taking the Asian version of MMA to the next and natural level, expanding it, making it more of a cooperative, giving fighters far more opportunity to fight, which is one of the things I really like about it. That's it's an open forum for fighters, lots of gyms, lots of promotions, lots of fighters cooperating and co-promoting. It can only be good for the sport.
Yeah, absolutely. I think you're completely right there. And I mean, you touched on an interesting subject there. North American MMA and Asian MMA are kind of almost two different sports, aren't they? Because the culture, I mean, not two different sports, but the culture is so different. The audiences are different. The things that audiences are looking for in a show, quote unquote, are different.
Very much so. Very much so. And that the gap between them, it's becoming a chasm now. It's quite different. I mean, one of the things I don't like about what happened after the unfortunate demise of Pride was that the words mixed martial arts kind of got lost, and it became, you know, a blood sport, and people talk about fighting, and the fans respond differently to that. And I know, I understand that. I mean, it's a different market, but I like the fact that ONE FC is going to bring it back to the mixed martial arts. There's a 5,000-year history of mixed martial arts in Asia, and it's sort of lost, I think, if you don't still have that Bushido spirit, either in the cage or in the ring. And the Bushido spirit is what I'm looking forward to seeing more of come March when I do my first ONE FC.
Well, I'm in March already,
my goodness.
Yeah. I think that's one of the main differences between Asian mixed martial arts and U.S. mixed martial arts. In America, it's more of a fight, and in Asia, it's more of a martial arts competition. And that's one of the reasons I like what ONE FC are doing, because they're taking champions in various different martial arts and putting them in that MMA settings. It's kind of come full circle back to 1993 when you had different traditional martial artists competing in the U.S.
I absolutely agree with you. Is that Brad?
That's Brad,
right?
Yes. Your biggest fan.
I just hear Brad talking. Hi, Brad.
So what do you, in your estimation, Lenny, what makes a good show for the Asian market?
I lost you a little bit. What makes a good show for the Asian market? Is that what you said?
Yes.
Yeah. I think, well, part of it is that, as we discussed already, it's the history of it, right? So it's a celebration. It's kind of like a matsuri, or what they call a festival here is a matsuri, before they even get into the ring or the cage. It's a celebration of the athlete and of the sport he is about to show his prowess in. So the build-up to it, the music, the fanfare, the pomp and circumstance is really important. It's all part of the whole package. You know, it's not just, hey, this guy's going to get into the cage and he's going to beat somebody else up right now. You know, it's more like, here comes your greatest hero. And here comes someone who's representing a particular style of mixed martial arts, particular discipline. If you happen to like that discipline and you happen to be curious how that discipline's going to do in the cage against an expert in another discipline, you know, if it's Muay Thai, Jiu-Jitsu, kickboxing, you know, you're going to be really excited about that. It's sort of like your team, you know, if you're watching football, your team's coming out onto the field, and I do mean soccer by that. Like Brett, I'm an expat American. When you see your team come out, you know, that's part of the thrill of it, isn't it? So when you see your athlete coming down the ramp, you know, you want to celebrate the fact that he's about to go in there and do his best at what he does very well.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm going to use that word, matsuri. That's perfect. That exactly describes everything that at least that I want a mixed martial arts event to be. And some are really, really good at that. Some are, as you said, are more about the fight and not so much about the celebration and about the ceremony.
Yes.
So when you're announcing, and I get asked this question all the time, so now I get to ask announcer questions.
Okay.
when you're announcing a fighter, I mean, what's going through your mind, and how do you sort of gear up for an event when you know whether it's an undercard fight or whether it's a main event fight?
Again, I've only heard part of that. I think we're being affected by solar flares or maybe the earthquake right now. There's a little tiny quake just now. How do I change the call depending on the fighter? Is that what you said?
How do you prepare yourself?
How do I prepare myself? I don't. I do try to work on the fly as much as possible. Inspiration is really important. We do have rehearsals, of course, especially in Japan. They're meticulous here, which is one of the reasons why they put on good shows. But you kind of have to go with a bit of the in-the-moment inspiration as well, because we don't rehearse everything.
Yeah.
I try to pay attention to a fighter's style, to their individual personalities, if I've gotten the chance to meet them, certainly to their entrance music, which in most cases they themselves have chosen, and of course the style of fighting they're going to do. Also, I listen to the audience's feeling, you know, the pulse from the audience. But otherwise, no. You mean actually like doing gargling and the throat exercises and things like that? I don't. I don't do any prep. Terrible, isn't it?
Well, I'm often amazed, particularly when I watch the old Pride reels, at how you go and go and go and go. I mean, I do 12 or 13 fights and I'm done. My voice is gone. And I mean, amazing, your voice is just fantastic.
I think it's because, right now you can't tell because I've actually got a cold today, but I think it's because I've got opera training and musical theater training behind me, so I use the same techniques I would use then. At the end of a really, really long day, actually the lower part of my back hurts because that's where I'm pushing the air up from. So I'll come home with a really sore back, really sore shoulders from pushing the air out and projecting, excuse me, as much as I can. So even though I've got a mic in front of me, I kind of forget that. Maybe in musical theater, we were always taught to sing to the back of the house.
Sure.
So I think, sorry?
I was saying it's much the same when you're announcing. So yeah.
It's exactly the same. The only difference is that I'm sitting down most of the time, which actually makes it a little bit more difficult. Probably that's why my back hurts so much. It's because it's easier to support the voice when you're standing.
Sure. So Lenny, we're just about out of time for this segment. I wonder if you would be so kind as to do an ident for us and just say, "This is Lenne Hardt, and you're watching The Cage."
Is that all you want me to say?
You
want me to
say whatever you'd like.
Freeman!
That was brilliant.
I want to say that.
Better.
I want to say that too. Okay. All right, and now I would like to say, "This is Lenne Hardt, and you're watching The Cage."
That was fantastic. Amazing. Lenny, thank you so much. And I
hope
to catch
you
again soon.
Nice talking to you both. Nice talking to you, Brad.
Take care.
Thank you. Bye now.
Bye-bye.
That was fantastic. I can't even believe
no,
that we
no,
just
no.
talked to Lenne Hardt.
I was just enjoying the stories and a bit dumbfounded there.
Yeah. So 1FC, new gig for her. We've got a VT. Let's have a look at what's coming up with 1FC.
My first fight in 1FC, I lost.
Oh! All over! What an upset!
Oli's fight with Filipe is good, but he didn't manage to finish Filipe.
5 straight wins and then now a loss, so I have to make up for it.
Oli wants to redeem himself by beating me. I feel that I will be the stepping stone for him.
Come on, man. Use him as a stepping stone? No way. If anything, it's the other way around. Edwards is a strong fighter, but using him as a stepping stone, I mean, what am I stepping down the ladder?
Ole has an amazing reputation. He's one of the most popular fighters in Asia right now. Edward Filayang, definitely up and coming, and he is looking to take Ole's glory. You better believe Ole doesn't want to let that go. And he is going to put up an amazing fight, and Edward never, never backs down.
The takedown. Oh, beautiful.
I will make every effort that I have to win this fight.
I'm not really worried. I'm just going to go in there and bang my usual style, and wherever the fight may go, I'm ready for it.
Oh.
This fight is a chance to show that I'm the best lightweight, not only here in the Philippines, but in 1FC in the whole world.
It's gonna be good to make it or break it. I'm emphasizing on break it.
Everybody has been dying to see this fight. These guys step into the cage and they hold nothing back. And let me tell you, don't blink, because someone is gonna get knocked the hell out.
Edward, it's been a long time coming. It's finally going down, so I hope you're ready.
Oli, I'm ready. Let's go.
Let's go.
Yeah, that's going to be a great fight.
You know what? I've seen that trailer probably 25 times, and I get chills every time I watch it.
Absolutely. It's going to be a fantastic card. You've also got Melvin Manoff on there and Crusher Kawajiri from Pride as well. So
yeah.
Top to bottom, absolutely stacked.
Yeah, really good. We're going to talk a bit more about that card when we come back. Stay tuned for more of Sports Tonight Live presents The Cage. When we come back after the break, talk a bit more about 1FC, and we've got some new guests in the studio. Welcome back to Sports Tonight Live presents The Cage. So far, what an amazing show. We've had the Queen of MMA, Lenne Hardt. Now we're going to talk to the Kings of MMA. Joining me in studio now is Tommy and Louis K.O. King. Guys, really, really great to see you.
How you doing?
Yeah, good. Thanks so much for taking the time out.
No worries.
Coming to visit us. I mean, you guys are just tearing it up. You've got some big fights coming up. Louis, I've had the pleasure of announcing you and watching you on several occasions. Pretty nice piece of hardware you got there.
Do you like it? It's my new belt, mate.
That's fantastic.
One of many.
One of many, absolutely.
It's almost as shiny as some of your belts, I bet.
Or his shoes. As shiny as his shoes, I think. I think that's as shiny as his shoes.
I remember the night that you won that belt. In fact, I was having a conversation online earlier today, and people were talking about the most brutal knockouts ever. And I threw that one in the mix because I thought it was awesome. So let's have a look at the night you won that belt.
Brilliant.
And one of the most brutal knockouts ever.
Brilliant.
To see them fighting one another is absolutely phenomenal.
It's one of these fights where I wouldn't want to be either one of these in there, but as a spectator, I am absolutely loving it.
So straight away, both guys, we're edge range, little right hook, King with a combination here.
Bit of a slip there, I think. And look at the stance of Marwea straight away. Different 20 fights MMA. He's got that lead leg out, and he's looking to throw different kicks.
He's out cold. A big left hook from
KO
King.
King.
Wow. Unbelievable.
Still out. He's still out. Wow.
Just watching your faces, that's really
such a wicked day that was, I tell you. Best day of my life. We trained so hard for that fight as well.
Yeah. And I mean, it's not like you just went in there with some slouch. I mean,
no,
Mark
I was gonna,
Weir is
absolute legend.
Yeah.
Absolute legend. I mean, he hasn't lost a fight. I mean, he was 19 wins, no losses, and I got in there and it was surprising because I even hit him and I even paused for a while because I didn't even realise how quick it went. So, but you know, fair play. He's a really nice fella as well. He wishes me all the best in my career.
Yeah, I know Mark is a good guy, but yeah. I remember on that night and after that knockout, I mean, we were all standing around saying, is he going to get up? Is he going to wake
up?
That
was worrying
vicious
for me as well. Yeah. I was really worrying because I actually had to pause and I was actually thinking to myself, damn, you know, I want him to get out. I hope he does get out. And I even went over and helped him out as well. I helped him get up and, you know, he shook me hand and that. But really nice fella, really nice fella. But best day of my life. Well-earned belt, well-earned belt.
Yeah. Well, as you're saying, one of many.
Yeah, exactly, definitely.
So, I mean, obviously by your name, Louis K.O. King,
which I had named from UCMMA.
Well, exactly. Yeah. And so it's becoming sort of a habit with you is just...
I've got to live up to the reputation, haven't I?
We said earlier, they all fall the same, don't they?
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. They all fall the same.
Yeah.
Exactly.
So you've got another big fight coming up on UCMMA.
Tell us a bit about that. I've offered the light heavyweight title out. Unfortunately, the guy I'm fighting is not fighting now, so I've got another guy who stepped in to fight me called AJ Woodhouse.
Yeah.
He's a very credible fighter. He's a Taekwondo champion. So he's willing to fight, which is wicked because, you know, I was sitting there worrying, I trained my ass off and I thought there wasn't going to be a fight. But he stepped up. Dave O'Donnell was finding me a fight, luckily. So thanks to Dave for finding me the fight and all that. And I'm just going to look forward to it, mate. But I'm going to go in there and I'm going to try and end this fight the same way to get my next belt.
Well, you keep doing that, you get a reputation. People
exactly
want to fight you.
I know. I'm having that trouble at the moment.
It's quite interesting. This guy says he's got a Taekwondo background. Obviously, Mark Weir had a Taekwondo background,
he was a world class as well.
Do you think that some of your preparation for the Weir fight is going to carry over into this one? So you didn't really get a lot of time to showcase it against
Exactly. I mean, we prepared for all rounds as always. But, I don't think there's going to be much to my changing in my training for this fight. I think I'm just going to do exactly as I did before and just up it a bit because obviously I'm carrying a bit more weight for this fight. So obviously we'll learn a few more things. But, really looking forward to it. Yeah, it's going to be exciting.
And Tommy, we're going to start hearing and seeing from you
well.
So you've got a big one coming up with Jimmy Miller,
Yeah, it's going to be a tough one. Yeah. You know, lots come out strong, don't he?
Yeah. So, but what's it like? I mean, you guys, I can only imagine your mom when she, you know, hears noise upstairs, just, what's going on up there? And you guys say, nothing. One of you's out cold on the floor.
Yeah.
So do you guys train together? I mean, do you spend a lot of time in the gym properly?
Yeah, we help each other out a lot. We help each other out a lot, yeah. It's good. Not just fighting around the house, but we always train together. It's good because he hits hard as well, so it's nice to train with each
it's
other.
Good motivation, isn't it? It gives you a bit of motivation.
Exactly. So, it's good because we both know how each other train and we both know how we work, so it's better to work that way with each other as well, so.
Yeah, I think it's great when you see brothers, you know, that are involved, you see, like the Maguires, John and Tommy, outstanding. The Diaz, the Diazes, right? Kings. I mean, it's fantastic because it just sort of helps you stay sharp on your game and you know, exactly. give you somebody that's not going to go easy because you're sparring, but he's going to try to take your head off because he's your brother.
Exactly. Right? He pushes me a lot as well, don't you?
Yeah, I do.
That's a good thing I'll get out of it as well.
Yeah. Yeah,
it's what you need, don't it?
Yeah, I need.
I think it's good with family because I think sometimes family can push you harder because they know what they can get away with with you. So I think it's a good thing training with family. It can only help.
Oh, without a doubt, without a doubt.
We have fun, don't we?
Yeah, we do. It's always good fun. We bang the crap out of each other. It's good.
I'll tell you what. You have the best laugh in MMA.
Yeah.
Oh, thank you.
Absolutely. So they'll knock you out and then I'll laugh at you while you're on the ground.
Yeah, everyone says the same thing. Brilliant.
So Tommy, this is your K-1 debut?
Is that right?
Against Jimmy Yads?
Yeah, UK-1 debut, yeah.
Yeah. So that's an outstanding fight for your first round out.
Yeah, it's gonna be different because I've been used to the 10-ounce gloves.
Yeah.
So this is the first time in the 4-ounce. So it's just going to be, the whole game plan is going to change and stuff like that. You know, my mindset's still going to be the same. Don't get me wrong. I'm still going to go in there and do what I have to do. But it's just the, you know, obviously because there's not much protection, is there really, with the hands and stuff like that. So I'm just going to
attack for you this time, won't it, bro?
That's it. Yeah. So just same mindset, just different.
So do you find your training a bit more technical for something like this?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah.
You don't have, you know.
That's it. Yeah. So I'm just going to move around a bit more than what I do usually.
Yeah.
And just play it out like that, really.
Enjoy it, yeah.
Jimmy Miller's known as, you know, a bit of a joker, and he gets all dressed up and everything. Are you prepared for the mind games when they
come out? Hiding the fear, you know, I can smell it a mile away. So it's not going to be no different to any other fighter, I thought, really. So just go in there and do what I have to do.
Can't hide his fear behind a mask, can he?
No, exactly. he's a good fella, though, don't get me wrong.
Yeah, he's a good
lad. Like you say, he's a joker.
Yeah. Well, we were talking, in fact, with Lenny at the first half of the show about sort of the ceremony, what she called the Matsui around the fight. All about your walk-in, all about your preparation, all about your, you know, sort of the ceremony. What do you think about that? Because, like I said, so Jimmy dressed up like the Joker, and that's kind of his thing. But what's it like for you when you're first getting ready for a fight, when you're getting ready to think about your walkout?
I don't really think about the walkout and stuff like that. And, you know, I want to go and impress in the cage. I don't have to do that walkout stuff. I just got my mind fixed on one thing, you know, and that's the winning. I don't have to go into, you know, wear masks and stuff like that, makeup and all that lot. Go in there and do my thing and just thrive on the win afterwards. That's what I look forward to.
Exactly.
Yeah. And so are you guys going to be cornering each other on the night? Because it's the same card, isn't it?
Yeah. I'm going to be cornering first when he comes out first. And then when my fight comes out, then he's going to be doing my corner as well. Mm. So help each other out the night. It'd be nice. Mm.
Yeah. And where do you guys train? Where's your normal gym training?
It's in Hazelmere, Coliseum Team King in Hazelmere. Yep. That's where all the action happens, and obviously our friend Ollie Beard, Muscle Link Gym, we train there for our strength and conditioning and weight training there. So we do our weights there, strength and conditioning there, caveman training, and then we do all our sparring and punching around down at our club. So yeah, it's really good.
Do you tend to seek each other out when you're sparring? I mean, there's obviously a room full of guys, but you know, let's go.
It's because we're brothers. We know where we're going to hit, don't we? Yeah. It's almost reading each other's minds.
Yeah.
So it makes it tougher, which is good.
Yeah, it's like fighting yourself, isn't
it? Yeah, exactly.
Mirror image.
Yeah, it makes it more fun. Yeah. I like
Outstanding. I'm still looking forward to this event because, I mean, the whole card top to bottom is absolutely stacked.
It's a wicked card.
Yeah.
Wicked night.
And I'm looking forward to seeing some big things from you. I was at another event where Jeremy Bailey's come out of retirement. Dave, please put that fight on. Please. I want to see Louis and Jeremy. I think that would be an absolute cracker.
Boom!
Exactly.
Something's getting cracked.
Yeah.
I ain't this nut.
Yeah. Should be on your t-shirt.
That's brilliant. I might have to.
Yeah. it's been a real pleasure. Like I said, I've been sat cage side on several of your bouts, been able to dance you and absolutely love to watch you do your thing.
Thank you, cheers.
Tommy, can't wait to see you start doing your thing as well.
Can't wait to get in there. So,
yeah, really, really looking forward to that night.
Cheers, man. Good.
So we had a bit of news around Rampage this week as well. I know that's a topic near and dear to your heart.
Yeah. Well, he's thrown the wobbler again, as he's wont to do. But it looks like it's serious this time. He's finally going to be out of the UFC. It's been revealed today that he's got one more fight on his contract. It's going to be with Shogun. Yeah. So it's a rematch of a classic fight they had in Pride. And the UFC have said they're going to let him go afterwards. So it seems that the tumultuous relationship has finally come to an end.
Yeah. Well, he's another, I mean, he's an absolute legend, Rampage. I've been chasing him on Twitter trying to get him to come on the show. So Hollywood Army, come on, help me out. Let's tweet to Rampage, tell him he's got to come on the show. love to have a chat with him. He comes in and out of the UK quite a bit as well. So.
He does, yeah. I mean, he was training with the Wolf Slayer for a while. Obviously, the Wolf Slayer doesn't really exist at the moment, but yeah. His manager's, you know, obviously based up there. So he's around. We'll have to try our best to entice him in one day. But yeah, crazy to see Rampage out of the UFC, and it makes you wonder where he's going to go. And you know, we've just had Lenne Hardt on ONE FC, big promotion in Asia. Rampage loves fighting in Asia.
That might be, yeah, that might
could
be a good
shout. Could be where we see him pop up next.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. Yeah, so like I said, we're chasing him on Twitter. Follow us on Twitter, @thecage.stl. All the news from the cage, everything that's coming up, future guests, previews of the shows. Also, we post links to past shows at @thecage.stl. Man, there's so much else I want to talk about.
we never have enough time.
I know it. So I think we are just about out of time here, but ONE FC, fantastic card. We didn't even get to talk about Super Fight League, which happened last weekend.
We'll make time in the future.
We will, because I absolutely want to talk about that promotion, because I've got some thoughts, and I just thought it was really interesting and really brilliant for a first time out, so we'll talk about that. We've got Bama coming up. We've got MMA Show Live coming up. We've got UCMMA coming up.
Full Contact Contender 2 this weekend.
Yeah, full
I'll be there doing the commentary, doing the interviews, get my Joe Rogan on.
Yeah.
Yeah,
get your
that.
Joe Rogan on. Fantastic. Yeah, so there's so much coming up. Guys, you got any plugs you want to make? Anybody you want to thank?
I want to thank my brother for the training as well for this fight, mate.
Oh,
my
brother.
Gary Bond, the manager, who has managed to get us on this show. Really good show as well, by the way, Brett.
Oh, cheers.
Cheers, mate. Thank you very much.
Yeah. Yeah, our coach Matt Powell
for the training, yeah.
And just family and friends for the support, and Ollie Beard, yeah, Link. For
and all the sponsors on the day, you know, yeah. Full sponsoring, so thank you very much. And the friends and family, of course, and fans, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
You have to thank the fans, they're out there supporting. Yeah.
Well, it's been a pleasure to have you guys on the show,
thank
as
you
we do
much.
Every week, for my guests. Limited edition, it's go time, Hollywood T-shirt.
Brilliant.
Lovely, thank you very much.
Tommy King, Louis King.
Thank you very much.
Welcome to the Hollywood Army.
Thank you.
Cheers.
Cheers.
Stay tuned next week. We've got some more really, really interesting guests. We've got some more topics to cover. But for now, it's not go time, but it's time to go. See you next week on Sports Tonight Live presents The Cage.